In the days that follow, an accident reconstructionist is hired to help the concerned parties understand the events leading up to the crash, as well as the severity of impact. The accident reconstructionist will generally inspect the accident scene, taking photographs and laser measurements of the remaining evidence, including tire marks, gouges, and debris. Using these measurements, the reconstructionist can construct a scale diagram of the scene, including the locations of the various pieces of evidence documented at the scene. A model of the vehicle can be placed within the diagram, so as better to understand the vehicle's pre-impact trajectory, as well as the impact configuration. The tire marks left on the road suggest a vehicle yawed toward the left prior to impact. Using 3D CAD software, the reconstructionist can perform a fit to the laser measurements taken of the yaw marks while at the scene. Using this fit, the reconstructionist can obtain the radius of curvature for the outside front tire mark and use this radius to estimate the pre-yaw speed by applying laws of physics. With an estimate of the vehicle speed during the initial phases of the yaw maneuver, an animation can be produced to further help understand the accident sequence. In the subject accident, the primary calculation was derived by using centripetal force. Suppose a physicist is whirling a ball with mass m attached to a string of length r around in a circular trajectory. Let's suppose this ball maintains a constant velocity of v sub t. The centripetal acceleration A sub c, required to keep the ball moving along its circular trajectory, is given by the square of this velocity divided by r. The centripetal force associated with this acceleration is given by the product of m times a sub c. Let's now suppose our physicist has no way to know the magnitude of the centripetal force on the ball, but has an uncalibrated linear spring device handy, which allows him to measure the spring's change in length as he whirls the ball around. From Hooke's law, we know that the force on the ball is proportional to the spring's change in length. Let's also suppose the physicist has a device which allows him to precisely measure the ball's velocity. So our physicist knows the velocity, v sub t, and the string length, radius r. Suppose he conducts a series of experiments, whirling the ball around at various string lengths r, taking measurements of the ball's velocity each time. With each experiment, he is careful to keep the spring device's change in length constant at each trial, thereby ensuring that the centripetal force is the same from experiment to experiment. Suppose this is done four times. Create a graph of the square of v sub t versus the string length r for each experiment. The result should create a linear pattern, I hope. Fitting the data points using a linear regression, one should obtain a line whose slope is equal to the magnitude of the centripetal acceleration. Now let's have our physicist conduct another experiment, where he again carefully keeps the spring device at the same length as in the prior experiments, where the string has some length r prime. Using the linear regression result, the physicist can make an estimate of the ball's velocity using the expression the square root of the slope times r prime. Now returning back to the subject accident. Knowing the car yawed to the left implies that the car's trajectory can be approximated by assuming uniform circular motion during the initial phases of the turn maneuver. We know that centripetal acceleration caused by frictional forces between the tires and ground caused the car to deflect to the left. As a review, for an object of mass m sliding in motion along a horizontal plane, the frictional force can be approximated by the product of the coefficient of friction times the object's weight, mg. Setting the centripetal force term equal to the frictional force, mu mg, one can solve for the tangential velocity of the car. This is given by the square root of the product of r times g times mu. This is the so-called critical speed formula. This implies the ratio of the square of the tangential velocity to g is equal to the coefficient of friction times r. Now let's suppose we stage a series of yaw maneuver tests within our simulation environment. We accelerate our subject vehicle to speeds of 50, 60, 70, and 84 miles per hour. In each test, we reach a constant velocity, then let go of our accelerator, and then turn the steering wheel sharply to enter a yaw maneuver. We can then use our 3D CAD software to estimate the radius of curvature of the outside front tire mark. Plotting the square of the initial velocity by this radius, we obtain the plot shown here. Performing a linear regression fit, we obtain a line with slope of about 0.9. From the laws of physics, we know this approximates the coefficient of friction used in the tire force model within our simulation environment. We now have an expression we can use to estimate pre-yaw velocities within the simulation. This is given by the square root of 0.9 times r times g. Returning to our subject accident, our estimated radius of curvature was 357.7 feet. Putting this into our equation, we obtain a pre-yaw estimate of 69.4 miles per hour.